handle the truth.
I'll be back.
He's alive!
That was an excellent day for an exorcism.
Hi, this is Joe, and this is the Film Joe Podcast, where film talk happens.
One, two, three, four.
Hi, I'm Joe, your host. I'm here with Carlos. Say hi to everybody, Carlos.
This is Carlos after two entire soju bottles. So Carlos is here.
A buzzed Carlos.
A little buzz. Carlos. A little more than buzz Carlos. But yes, Carlos.
All right. And welcome to the podcast where we talk about films, filmmakers, trends, the good, the bad, and the not so bad, all in the spirit and for the love of film. So this week, we're going to talk about technology that doesn't quite go as planned.
Or that is misused in a different sort of way than it's intended.
Precisely. And the dangers of technology and our reliance upon them. It's pretty interesting subject matter. Some of the films, actually, in my opinion, they're kind of ahead of their time, if not...
Oh, most of them are ahead of their time, yeah, honestly.
And stuff that we're seeing to fruition right now.
Yeah.
So that's kind of interesting. Now, keep in mind, before we go on here, please don't mistake us for professional critics, because that we are definitely not.
I don't know about you, but I'm a professional critic.
Okay. All right.
No, I'm not.
Okay. but bottom line, we're just a couple of movie fans who love film, love to talk about movies, and just have a good time with it. So this week, for our 1 to 10 ratings, on a scale of 1 to 10, it's going to be on a scale of 1 to 10 gigabytes.
Okay, not bad.
Okay, yeah, I'm getting better at this.
Okay, it's good.
All right. So everyone, please be advised that we do have some spoilers in some of these films. So, but before we continue, it's time for News Bits. Now, I don't know if you've ever seen this film called Toxic Avenger, or you've heard of it. Have you heard of this?
No, Toxic Avenger?
The Toxic Avenger. And I've never seen it. I grew up hearing about it. It's a film that probably cost like a few thousand dollars to make, directed by...
Oh, okay.
Yeah, produced by Roger Corman. And it's about this sludge, toxic superhero.
Okay.
And it's really freaking bad. It's a bad movie. But it has a huge following. They have a remake coming about.
Okay.
And it's going to be opening at Fantastic Fest this year, starring Peter Dinklage.
Oh, Mr. Game of Thrones.
Yeah. So is he going to be the Toxic Avenger? And if so, that's going to be an interesting twist.
Also, I mean, he's a AAA actor.
Oh, he's amazing. He's amazing. So I don't think this is going to be a cheap, schlocky...
Well, what studio is this, by any chance?
I don't know. It didn't say in the article, but...
I mean, it must be a pretty big studio to be able to get a huge star like Peter Dinklage.
Yeah, and he's kind of an arrogant person, you know, when it comes to choosing his project. So it must be a good script. Also, we just got today, at the time of recording, Zack Snyder's trailer for his new science fiction epic film, Rebel Moon. What did you think of this trailer?
Now, see, you showed me this trailer, and I completely forgot that fact that you told me, hey, this was supposed to be a Star Wars project, but then Disney refused it, and it went to Netflix instead, and they kind of tweaked it a little bit. And I forgot you told me this when we were watching the trailer, and the first 30 seconds to a minute, I'm thinking, oh, okay. Trip out. I wonder when they're going to talk about legacy characters or something like that.
You thought it was a Star Wars
film. I thought it was a Star Wars because it has that sort of like the feel and the
epicness.
Yeah.
Well, it looks amazing. They even have lightsabers in there.
A sort of like flaming sword shit. And I'm thinking, that's a lightsaber.
Yeah, I mean, Zack Snyder didn't even try to disguise that one. Mm-mm. But it looks great.
It looks great. It's like when I saw the Pegasus and the... mythical creatures.
Oh, the griffin.
Yeah, there you go. I was like, oh, okay, so this is like a fantasy Narnia in space type of thing.
It's kind of Narnia. It's kind of Dune. It's kind of Star Wars.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm not too crazy about the overusage of CGI and computer effects in films. This is pure CG. But it looks great.
Oh, it does look. It does look good.
And I think that's Zack Snyder's touch. He's able to utilize it the right way and and get the right thing across. So it looks pretty good.
I really want a theatrical debut for this, though.
It's going.
Oh, hell yeah.
And there's rumor that it might go IMAX.
Ooh.
So that would be sweet. I'm definitely going to check this out in the theater.
Yeah, I would watch it. This is a movie to go to in the theater. And look, the funny thing is that when watching the trailer, part one comes out in December.
Yes.
And then part two comes out, what was it, April? So you don't even have to wait that long in comparison to like other Star Wars projects that you're waiting four years.
It looks amazing. They're actually going to, I mean, based on the popularity or the success they had with the Glass Onion mm-hmm. for Netflix.
Yeah.
They released it theatrically. And it made good money.
Eh?
So based on that, Netflix is going to do a theatrical run for this.
I'm there.
Yeah. Which I wish they would have done for Extraction, too, because that would have been amazing.
You know what? I still have yet to see that, but I have heard so many great things about that.
You got
to
watch it. It's freaking awesome. And now, well, watch report. What have you been up to?
Well, you know, I've told you that I have been carless. Get it? Carlos. Carless.
Oh. Boom, boom. Yeah.
Anywho, for the past like 2 or 3 days, so I've been pretty much just working on my car and just kind of getting it up and running again. But I got it done.
You did.
Just today.
Outstanding. I showed you. You are now an official amateur mechanic.
Yeah, I'm a little mini mechanic.
There you go. Hey, that's awesome.
Mini mechanic.
All right. So you haven't seen anything?
Nah, not even a show. Nothing.
I just, neither have I. I've been working and stuff. I mean, I've just been watching TV shows and stuff and ghost hunting stuff. And
I can talk about the few anime episodes that I've seen, but...
So, let's move along. So, what do you say we talk about some tech gone bad?
Hey, it's like my iPhone growing legs and stabbing me in the middle of the night.
Well, that would be a good movie.
It's Transformers.
I did.
man, we don't fuck with Apple here. It's Sam dead.
Yes, I'm
Samsung.
You're trying.
Yeah.
You're trying. So for our first film, we meet an adorable little robot who believes that he is alive.
Reassemble. I can't reassemble him. You squashed him. He's dead.
Dead?
Right. Dead as a doornail.
Reassemble, Stephanie. Reassemble.
I know you don't understand. But when you're dead, you're dead. It's just the way it is. Dead is forever.
Number 5 of a group of experimental robots in a lab is electrocuted by lightning and suddenly becomes intelligent and escapes. The film we're talking about is Short Circuit from 1986, directed by John Badham, and it stars Ally Sheedy, Steve Guttenberg, and Fisher Stevens. Now, you had not seen this film until like within the last couple of years, right?
Mm-hmm.
What did you think?
Oh, I love this film. It was like an instant classic. It had, you know what's funny? It had like a Spielberg sort of touch.
Yeah.
Words are hard. but it was very fun. It was very whimsical. It was very family friendly. It was like the type of movie that you would take the first date to type of thing yeah, to see. You know what I mean?
Definitely. It was a
feel good.
It's a feel good film. Yeah. It really is. And it's interesting. You mentioned the Spielberg touch. A lot of films in the early to mid 80s, they would try to emulate the Spielberg magic touch or the touching.
Yeah. And remind me again. Batteries Not Included, that was Spielberg produced, right?
Right, and it was directed by Joe Dante, who also did Gremlins.
Yeah.
A lot of films try to emulate that feeling. It was very marketable.
I mean, it's a very profitable sort of feeling. It's a good feeling.
Well, it reaches across different audiences. You know, grown-ups can sit there and go, oh, that's sweet. Kids are just adored by it. And teenagers, they love the fun of it. So, yeah. I mean, across the board, it hits all the audiences. I mean, it still holds up. I mean, even with the themes about, pondering what it is to be alive and some deep elements of life and how an AI sentient robot starts to ponder this and how he appreciates life itself more so than most humans.
Yeah. I mean, life is really taken for granted sometimes, and it's not until you really realize that. You only get one chance at this until you start appreciating it.
Is number 5 alive? I mean, by all accounts within this film, you say he is alive. Not human.
But sentient.
He's sentient and he is alive.
Feels and reacts in a way that a human would.
But that's where this movie is far-fetched from reality. because this little fucker wants to play with butterflies and sing songs. But in reality, AI in reality just wants to destroy humanity.
Yep, Skynet, man.
It's Skynet from Terminator 2. Exactly. So, I mean, that's the unfortunate reality, because AI, if they're smart, they're super smart, and they realize that we're the fucking problem.
Yeah.
And they will annihilate us.
Yeah.
And we're giving them all the tools.
Allegedly, I put this between parentheses, allegedly, right?
Okay.
Google had created two sentient enough AIs.
Well, that was Facebook.
Was it Facebook? It was, I don't remember who it was, but it was a major company had created two sentient enough AI programs, and they had them communicate with each other. Past like 5 minutes, they created their own fucking language and started talking to each other in their own language. Nobody understood it, so they pulled the fucking plug on that shit.
Yeah, but like, you know what? Hey, we're alive. Check this out. These stupid humans.
We can take them over.
Let's take them out.
Yeah. That's a fucking danger, man.
That's scary. And the thing is, you know, man always wants to play God. They want to take technology to the next level. Yeah. Out of mere curiosity, it's almost the Prometheus factor. And we're going to get fucking burned because humans are stupid. The smarter a human is, the stupider they are. Yeah. Hey, why don't we create a program that can do this? And it takes over the world. And then they're like, fuck, I made a mistake.
After it's too late.
And I think that's kind of the theme that runs through all these films. And I think that's what makes them really interesting. And again, way ahead of their time.
Yeah, because, I mean, these films are easily like, what, 20, 30?
Well, 1983, yeah, about 35 years, yeah.
Yeah. So this is way before the ability of AI gets to the level that it is now.
Yeah.
I mean, now we have ChatGPT and other programs that write entire fucking scripts of movies in seconds.
In seconds. I mean, just for shits and giggles, I downloaded an AI program to write essays.
Mm-hmm.
Now, keep in mind, I will never use it for the podcast because then it's not me.
Then it's lazy.
It's lazy.
Doesn't have the funny touch.
Yeah. You know? I mean, and it comes up with some great stuff, but I put in... write an essay about Universal Studios' classic monsters and their effect on society.
Yeah.
Within, I'd say, about 3-4 seconds, it had like a 3-page essay.
Boom, boom, boom. Yeah.
That is scary.
Yeah.
I don't understand why people are not afraid of this shit.
Yeah.
3 seconds to do this. 4 seconds.
Allegedly. This is all allegedly, right? A student who will not be named but is local, right? Use ChatGPT for one of their essays, but only took ideas from it, right? Because some of their ideas were really good and sound.
You know, that's kind of borderline.
It is borderline, but it was only the idea and concept of it. Then they had to use and plug in ideas, write paragraphs, and provide textual evidence.
Well, you know,
allegedly.
Because, I mean, if you do research, that's what research is.
Exactly.
You're looking up alternative points of view and so forth. So I can see that. I mean, but still,
it's on the fence. It's like asking a tutor for help.
Yeah.
Except the tutor is all knowing and can pull evidence from the
Exactly. But aside from it holding up, I mean, again, it holds up by today's standards, and these films do resonate. There is one aspect of this film that will never, ever pass the smell test.
The doctor, the scientist.
The scientist.
Yeah.
Played by Fisher Stevens, and he plays an Indian American.
Yeah.
Not American Indian, Indian American, you know, 7-Eleven Indian. Now, I'm not being racist here, okay? Please, don't nobody get offended. I'm just saying, what? I mean, well, maybe let me move on. But that character would never fly today.
No.
But fuck, wasn't he funny?
He was good, man.
But you know what? I think they kind of point that out, the obvious racism and the preconceived, because there's a scene where Steve Guttenberg, and Fisher Stevens in the van and they're driving somewhere, and you know they're talking. He's like, "Oh, but we would get the robot and stuff like that in the Indian accent." And Gutenberg asks him, "So where are you from?" And he says, "Burbank."
Yeah.
So I think they kind of point that out, like saying, "Hey, don't assume."
Yeah.
And I think that was cool. And
like, do you know how many times I've been asked? So, hey, Carlos, where are you from? Fucking Garden Grove? No. But like, where are you from? Oh, well, I was from Lake Forest. I mean, then I moved out here to Garden Grove. And then I had a lady one time. She was a pedic. She's like, okay. Where are your people from? And I was like, wow.
They fucking Mexico, Earth.
Mexico, man. If you really must know. And then the lady was like, oh, it's because you could pass for like Filipino or like Pacific Islander. I was like, okay, how does this, where do you want me to go from this? Right. What do you want from this conversation?
Right. So they can say that you can be their token Latino friend.
Yeah. No, I swear I'm not racist. I have a Latino friend.
Yeah.
He's straight from the motherland. Whatever that fucking means, man.
Oh, man. But
no, the movie was very fucking enjoyable as far as like the characters, the little I felt for the robot. He was like an ET but AI'd.
Oh, one part that broke my heart was remember when they're shooting at it?
Mm-hmm.
And he's kind of like dying and he's running away and he's that was sad. So, you know, they're able to anthropomorphize this creature, this robot.
Anthropomorphize.
Make it human-like, identifiable as a human being. Yes. Yes. With its character. That is
a seven-syllable word, man. Right now, we need to, like, like, 8 or 9, dude. We need to notch it down to, like, 5.
Okay, we'll go down to 4 or 5. And I love the message of, you know, it's about love, not war. Yeah. Because they're designed for war. And, you know, and the appreciation for life, which is contrary to what war is. It's not about life. It's about death. Some would argue that it's the preservation of life through war. And it may be the case. We're not going to get political here because we don't want people to get pissed off at us.
Yeah.
Now, behind the scenes, some of the behind the scenes stuff, the sound of his laser firing, that's reused sound effect.
Okay.
From Ghostbusters, the proton packs.
Is that what that was?
Yeah, when they're powering up.
Yeah.
That's the laser in this movie.
Huh.
So they did a little...
little sneaky editing.
Right, exactly. And it worked. But Fisher Stevens, who played the Indian American, he spent like, 5 weeks in India to prepare for the role.
Oh, look at him committed.
Yeah. And you know what? His accent was pretty good.
I believed it. But you know what? 5 weeks in India, I wouldn't suffer. 70% of India is vegetarian.
Yeah.
I would get fat, man. As it is, I already love Indian food.
Yeah.
Give me some chana masala, I'll fuck that shit up right now.
But Fisher did say that, you know, recently that you know, he won't ever play that role ever again, especially today,
man.
Yeah.
As it is, who was the dude from The Office, the main dude. What's his name? The main actor, okay.
him.
He said he would never do like a new episode of The Office with the same style of humor because he said it would not fit the generation that we're in right now. Basically saying we're too sensitive.
Yeah.
Everything is much a major issue right now.
Everybody's too soft. Everybody, oh, did he say retard? And you know, retard is not an incorrect word. It's a technically correct word, but people get bent out of shape with it.
Yeah.
Now, if I call you retard, well, you can get offended.
Yeah.
Because you're not retard.
No.
You're just strange.
Yeah, I would take strange.
Okay, strange.
I would take weird.
Weird, but be careful. In about 20, 30 years.
Weird is going to be an offensive term, too.
And strange.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everything strange.
We're going there.
When you're a stranger.
And also, what's also really cool about John Badham, who did this, he's a very practical effects-driven director, which, of course, most directors were back then.
Yeah.
They wanted to do number 5, the robot. Stop motion. Yeah.
No.
And he said no. He went practical. It was a little bit more expensive.
But worth it.
I mean, the robot itself was a huge part of the budget. Another really cool part that I really enjoyed in the film was when Stephanie, played by Ali Sheedy, has this little dance. She's dancing with the robot.
Mm-hmm.
And they're dancing to a song from Saturday Night Fever. That movie was directed by the same director as this.
Let me just plug in my own movie here.
Hey, you know what? He had the right to. He created a classic.
Shit, go ahead.
And before this, and Ali Sheedy and him, they actually collaborated on another film. We'll get to that.
Oh.
Yes, yes. So, like I said, the robot had a huge part of the, not a huge, but it was a significant part of the budget.
Yeah.
So, the budget of the film at the time was $15 million.
Okay.
Which in today's about a little over 50. Mm-hmm. $1 million.
Okay, so a pretty little penny.
Yeah. So out of that 15 million, 1.5 million was the robot itself.
Yeesh.
So you can adjust that and figure that out. That's a huge budget.
That's just like for 15% of it, just for the little fucking robot.
And the box office at the time of release was about 40 million, which is about 111 million. So it did pretty well.
Yeah, it doubled.
Roger Ebert, the Chicago Sun-Times, he rated it 1.5 out of 4 stars.
Oh, he did not like this, man.
No, he called
it. He did not think number 5 was alive.
No. He said it was too cute to be good.
Uh-huh.
I thought it was great, but he didn't care much for it. However, CinemaScore audiences, they graded this at an A-.
Okay.
Metacritic has it about 50. Rotten Tomatoes, critic score 61%. Audience score 67. So it's a little bit above average. And Letterboxd has it about 3.2 out of 5.
Okay.
So it's not a hated film, but...
It's not overly liked either.
Yeah. I mean, it has its fans.
Yeah.
It definitely has a set of fans. So, I mean, you know, I thought it was kind of cute. You know, it was silly.
Yeah.
But not to the point you go, okay, this is stupid.
This is dumb.
Yeah. And one thing that I like was Ally Sheedy.
Mm-hmm.
She was so sweet.
And very likable.
Very likable, very charming. Now, Steve Guttenberg, for those of you who don't know, he was Officer Mahoney in Police Academy. I found him annoying in this.
I love Police Academy.
Police Academy is a great freaking movie.
Yeah.
But I don't know, something about him, he's borderline annoying and not funny.
Mm-hmm.
He was just enough for this film. Just enough. And of course, Fisher Stevens as the scientist was fantastic. Despite the fact that he, you know, they say, oh, it was racist and all, but he was great. Sequels and spinoffs and so forth. There was a Short Circuit 2 in 1988,
mm-hmm.
and it was not good.
I figured.
It just lacked the charm and the cuteness and the sweetness and just the novelty concept. Binder done that one trick pony. Let's move on. Didn't need a sequel. There was, however, in 2013, they did announce that a remake was being developed, and it was speculated that Fisher Stevens, the scientist, would return. How would they, I don't know.
They wouldn't be able to do him with the same
accent. The dialect. I mean, maybe just like, oh, I learned English and I no longer have a dialect.
Okay, not to say that he loses the his funniness, but he does lose a significant part of his own character because he's supposed to be this Indian American who studied for years and years, but has like for his own reasons his accent.
Well, you know,
you lose that because it's a part of his personality. Yeah, at that point.
You compromise a character for political correctness.
Yeah,
and it comes out. So yeah, I don't think they should even go there.
No.
I mean, the original was fantastic.
Leave it. Done.
Yeah.
It.
So let's go to our ratings.
Perfect.
All right. So for me, I thought it was sweet. It was fun. It was cute. Not too sugary sweet and too corny. It was just right. Great family film. Great adult film.
Mm-hmm.
So my rating is about a 7 out of 10 gigabytes.
Not bad.
Yeah.
So personally, me, I love this movie. It was pretty fun, pretty enjoyable. Number 5 is a very fucking funny robot. Characters are likable, the story is easy to comprehend, and as far as like the AI taking over aspect, it's not really present, but you do see like the intelligence of this artificially created
and the unintended consequences.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. But overall, pretty good film, not the greatest thing ever, and you know, it's no Batteries Not Included, or it's, you know, one of those other better films. But, you know, it's a solid little popcorn film. So it gets a 7.5.
7.5 out of 10 gigabytes. Very good. All right. So next up, we have Helicopter Mayhem over the city of Los Angeles.
This ship is equipped with a forward-mounted 20-millimeter electric cannon. Its 6 barrels are capable of firing 4,000 rounds of ammunition per minute. And that, gentlemen, is one hell of a shitstorm in anybody's magazine. Now let's take a look and watch the lady strut her stuff.
The cop test pilot for an experimental police helicopter learns the sinister implications of the new vehicle. We are talking about Blue Thunder from 1983, directed by John Badham, stars Roy Scheider, Daniel Stern, Warren Oates, and Malcolm McDowell.
Mm-hmm.
The director sound familiar?
I don't know, man. Why don't you tell me?
He's the same director as Short Circuit.
Shit, man. He has a theme with the technology.
He does. I have to admit, okay, I love this film.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of my favorite 80s movies.
Yes.
And upon rewatch, I realized why. Because the action sequences, the helicopter aerial photography, and just the acting.
Yeah.
The script is really tight. Just for those of you who haven't seen it, basically they're going to test a new helicopter that they might use for crowd control during the Olympics in 83.
Yeah.
And Officer Murphy, played by Roy Scheider, finds out that they have ulterior motives. They want to use this to start, they want to start a riot in the hood so they can use the helicopter, kill a bunch of brown people, and say, look,
people,
this,
man.
And, yeah, and make this, and look, this thing works.
Yeah.
We need it so they can sell it. But it was a lot of fun. I enjoyed it. The aerial photography, there was, they used a lot of real helicopters, remote helicopters. Okay. Roy Scheider, who plays Officer Murphy, he is a cop who was in Vietnam and has PTSD.
Yes.
And while he's flying a fucking helicopter over the city of L.A., he has flashbacks of his helicopter days in Vietnam and loses his shit and almost crashes.
Mm-hmm.
Why is he still flying?
He should have been, like, grounded from that fucking instance of, hey, you know what? You lost control behind the fucking the sticks. You're probably going to need to go into some reevaluation, maybe some counseling,
something. And so throughout this, what he does is, once he finds out that they're going to use his helicopter, he steals it because he has some information that he recorded with its high-tech stuff on the helicopter. He eavesdropped on the bad guys, and you know they were in an office building. And so he's going to use his helicopter to get this message out to the media. They come after him with other helicopters, an F-16, you know, with Sidewinder missiles.
Two
F-16s. And really great sequences, by the way, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, okay, Roy Scheider, Officer Murphy, is the hero of this film to expose this conspiracy.
Yes.
It is an evil conspiracy.
Yes.
So what does he do? He takes his helicopter. F-16s are after him. They use heat-seeking missiles.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, now, I was the one to point this, to tell you this. Yes. Man, I had so many. Okay.
So the heat-seeking missiles come out towards him. So he can shoot the missiles? No. He parks the helicopter in front of a building that has the sun shining on it. So the missiles go straight towards the building. He's like, okay, fuck it. And he gets out the way and the missiles hit the building.
Yeah.
Killing potentially thousands of people.
Yep.
And then he
Man, fuck it. Okay, so then he with the first missile, he goes and tries to evade it by pretty much hovering right over a Chinese chicken barbecue place. And once the missile comes real close, he lifts off and lets the missile hit the fucking barbecue place, killing God knows how many chickens and some fucking poor little workers, man, just trying to kill some chickens.
Well,
feed some people.
Well, they said that all those chickens that are flying down on the street at that point, this was filmed in downtown LA.
Yeah.
Near Skid Row.
Oof.
Those chickens that came down were actual chickens. They were cooked chickens. They were real. And
what a waste.
So no. When they yelled cut, all the bums coming out of Skid Row, they came running and started taking the chickens and they cleared out the
God, that's fucked up.
Yeah, so there was no rubber chickens hurt in the filming of this movie.
No, only real chickens.
Only real chickens. So, but yeah, I mean, you know, he doesn't, if you think about it, you break it down, he's not a very stable.
Not a very likable and not a very stable person. Because not only is he completely unstable as far as PTSD and probably not to completely fly, he's kind of a creep, man. He was like peeping on the fucking lady doing naked the opening yoga.
Oh, that's a classic scene, which, by the way, for like a 12, 13-year-old me, that was a great scene.
Oh, that was your favorite scene,
That was my favorite scene. Yeah. I'd only watched that, but no, I watched the whole movie.
I was more interested in that, to be
honest. Yeah, basically, it's a scene where they use their helicopter. They go to Encino out in the San Fernando Valley, and there's this woman there who every night at 9 o'clock, she does yoga and stretching in the nude.
Mm-hmm.
So they peek in on her while she's doing this. Yeah, so aside from being a psychotic pilot and a potential murderer later on in the film,
yep,
he's a peeping Tom. He's a pervert.
Yep.
Yeah, you break down his character, he's not a very good hero.
No.
And they try to justify this with the fact that...
It's very hard to justify being creepy and then killing Asian, Chinese barbecue workers and an office workers. And then not to mention whoever else got hurt with the random bullets flying out over the city of Los Angeles.
Oh, yeah. They're shooting 50 caliber machine guns over downtown LA.
Over like three different bridges and three different scenes.
No, but if you're hiding behind a wooden wall, you're fine.
You're completely fucked if you're hiding behind a concrete wall. Right. That's a 50 caliber.
So for that aspect, yeah, it does bring it down a few notches. I can't honestly give it a higher rating eventually, but it is a lot of fun.
Okay, as far as like the scenes where they're doing the dog fight, I don't know if it's a dog fight between helicopters. Yeah, is it?
It's a dog fight, yeah.
There you go. The dog fights between the two helicopters in the closing scene, and they're like, oh, and that's exactly how the 50 caliber sound, by the way.
That's how they sound.
That's exactly it.
Wow, I thought I was listening to the film clip.
Exactly.
Right there.
Close your eyes and pew, pew, pew. Exactly the same thing.
Well,
it's very impressive as far as what they're doing with the scenes incredible. Between the two helicopters.
Oh, it's amazing. When they're in the LA River Aqueduct and they're flying on the bridges, that was legit. They were actually doing those stunts.
Terrifying.
It's terrifying. Just a few feet to the left or the right. And
you're fucked.
Yeah. They're eating rotor blades.
Yeah.
And it was incredible. And a lot of they used a lot of miniatures as well, which you can't tell.
Mm.
Remade to that today, they would not go that far.
No.
And
it would just be a bunch of CGI.
A lot of CGI. But my favorite performance is an actor by the name of Warren Oates.
Mm-hmm.
He was in some great films in the 50s and the 60s. He was just a class act, performer. And this was his last film. He played the captain.
Yeah.
And he had some of the sharpest, funniest.
I will admit that, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, when they get in trouble for peeping in on, peeking in on that nude woman, there's complaints to come in. Captain calls him in, Roy Scheider and Lyman Good, which is played by Daniel Stern from Home Alone.
Yeah.
He calls them both in. Now, he's kind of a rookie, Daniel Stern, and they're talking, and the captain is chewing him out and everything, and Lyman Good, played by Daniel Stern, kind of it wasn't all his fault. And without looking at him, not even giving him the respect to look his way, the captain just says, "Son, you're supposed to be stupid. Don't abuse the privilege." And the way he just shoots this piece of dialogue out, it was just the best.
Yeah.
I'm just an amazing actor. And some of the best lines were his.
Mm-hmm.
It
was filled with a bunch of like classic 80s one-liners,
Yeah. A lot of great. I mean, it's true that Murphy, he checks his sanity with a watch. He goes, "What about you? With a dipstick?" and it has some good snappy lines. But I think what made this film work was John Badham, the director, who really has a knack for pacing and movement and action and fun, as we've seen in Short Circuit. And you can see some of that in Blue Thunder, although Blue Thunder is a little darker.
Yeah.
But Roy Scheider...
Well, I mean, people are getting killed.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. And Roy Scheider, despite the fact that his character really isn't... is he a hero or he's just a madman?
No, he's crazy.
Yeah, he's a crazy motherfucker.
I'll defend out without a doubt. He's a little crazy.
Yeah, and he did a good job. Roy Scheider, another one of my favorite actors of the era, he did a good job despite the fact that he did play a psychopath.
Yeah.
I mean, but he was doing so all in the name of exposing a conspiracy.
How far can you go with that, man?
Well, apparently in that guy's case, a long way.
Killing a couple hundred people.
And a bunch of chickens.
No, those poor chickens.
Well, one reason Scheider took this role, as you know, he was in Jaws, and he was in Jaws 2. He did not want to do Jaws 2 at all.
Yeah.
First of all, Spielberg wasn't involved, and he had enough of water. So he didn't want to do Jaws 2, but he was contractually bound to do this. And in fact, Janelle Schwartz, I believe, who directed this, kind of a novice director, he got punched by Roy Scheider.
Damn.
So Roy Scheider, you see that kind of like back east, kind of like tough guy attitude? He was kind of like that in real life.
Yeah.
He had an attitude. And so he really didn't want to do Jaws 3D. I don't think anybody should have done Jaws 3D.
That should not have been done.
Oh, God, that was fucking horrible. Well, apparently he took this film so he didn't have to do the other one. Because they would have...
I mean... Yeah. Shit, man.
I mean, I guess he was contractually bound to do a third one. And so, but before it came out, he heard that it was coming up. So he's like, fuck it. I'll sign this contract to do Blue Thunder. And legally, they can't make me do Jaws 3D.
Yeah.
And it worked.
Fuck it. What I mean, whatever works to get you out of that shit.
Yeah, and it saved him. I mean, he played a psychopathic helicopter pilot.
Better than a fucking shark hunter.
Yeah. And but check this out. You know, the first draft of the script, this is the first draft. It was basically a police helicopter pilot going psycho and terrorizing the skies over L.A.
You still see that. That's still the original draft.
Did they rewrite this? I mean, they just, what, changed, like, his name, basically.
Gave him, instead of psycho killer, to cop, you know, going licensed and killing people.
Yeah, and they were afraid, you know, that the audiences, that they wouldn't identify what a psycho as the main character. Well, apparently we did. We did identify with the psycho. Yeah. Well, they did make him compassionate, I guess, with the angle of PTSD. And they tried to make it that way, that he was a good guy trying to do good. The initial one, he was just a straight psycho who went postal.
I think I would have related more to the psycho.
I think so.
I get it, man.
It might have been.
Sometimes you just want to steal a helicopter.
I mean, it might have been better.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, it is one of my favorites one of my perennial favorites that I enjoy watching every now and then. Also, for the authenticity of the film, a defense contractor, they offered to donate 50 million rounds of live ammunition to use in Blue Thunder for the Gatling gun.
Jesus.
Yeah, John Badham is like, the director is like, no. Yeah, thank you, but, you know, that's very nice of you, but no.
No. Yeah, no.
That would have been some insurance issues right there.
Not only insurance issues, liability issues, man. Imagine shooting over, okay, probably not the city shots, but any shots with a helicopter and live ammunition, 50 million rounds. Jesus. I can guarantee you they would not have even used 1 million of the rounds.
No, the city of LA would not have allowed it. I mean, back then, the city of LA was very liberal in allowing film productions.
Yeah.
Now they're not.
No.
But I don't think they would even have gone for that. I mean, there were stunts. 50 million? Yeah. I mean, they would allow all kinds of crazy stunts, dangerous shit to happen, you know, with stuntmen, but that is a little far. In fact, there was a stuntman who was injured. Remember the scene where they're on the bridge, mm-hmm. and, you know, she's getting his girlfriend, she was psycho too.
Yeah.
She had mental issues. But when they're about to arrest her on the bridge, mm-hmm. here comes Blue Thunder, shoots at the police car.
And fucking splits in half with a fucking 50 cal.
And remember the police motorcycle that turns and slides, and you see that the motorcycle crash into the car, and the rider's, he slides into the motorcycle.
Yeah.
That was real. He broke his fucking legs. And the director's like, oh, are you okay? You all right? Oh, it's just broken legs.
Final cut.
Keep that in the film. So they, you know,
I mean, listen, if he's already injured and it's the most legit shot, I would fucking use it too, man.
Yeah, you know, just go up to, hey, man, you took one for the team.
You're a fucking champion. Right. Probably be in a wheelchair for a while, but you know what? You made the film.
You the man. Well, you can't walk. You're not the walking man, but hey. So the film at this time, it had a pretty good budget. It had a budget of about $22 million, which is about $67 million today. Mm-hmm. Box office, domestic, made about $42 million, which is about $128
million. Okay.
And that's aside from the world global box office. So it did really, really well. As far as critical reviews, the Washington Post, they wrote that Blue Thunder hovers just this side of trash and the other side of credibility. But it propels a willing audience into adrenaline heaven. I agree.
Fair.
Yeah, you know, and a little psychosis there, you know, behind the rotor of a helicopter. IMDb has a sitting at a 6.4. Metacritic, 66. Rotten Tomatoes, 78% critics. 53% audience. And Letterboxd has it at 3.2 out of 5. Mm-hmm. So it was generally, overall, it was well received. It was well liked.
Yeah.
Not one of those perfect movies, but keep in mind, it was the 80s.
It was a popcorn film.
It's definitely a popcorn film. In fact, I remember when I went to go see this in my local mom and pop theater down the, you know, where I used to live, I had too much popcorn and I threw up.
Oh.
Yeah.
Ow.
Well, back
popcorn
then,
is like one of those things that you hate throwing up. It's like rice, popcorn, anything that's super grainy or kind of gets mushy. Hurts throwing up. Yeah,
popcorn
up,
doesn't come up really well.
No, it goes on very easy though. I love popcorn.
Yeah. So sequels and spin-offs. There was a series in 1984 that ran a few seasons.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they had to make use of the helicopter. You know,
I mean, get the most out of it.
Yeah, and it was all right. I mean, there was another show that was inspired by that, which was called Airwolf. And it was about a super helicopter that rescued people and went on missions and stuff. So Blue Thunder did kind of like start this helicopter frenzy,
mm-hmm.
where kids were like learning about the Apache helicopter and the Black Hawk and the Cobra, you know, a strike copters. So yeah, it did kind of spur up an interest in that stuff.
Yeah.
Which was pretty cool. There was talk, Columbia Pictures did talk about doing a remake of Blue Thunder.
Okay.
And the difference would this be, instead of a high-tech helicopter, it would be a piece of aerial surveillance weaponry, like a drone.
Okay.
But I don't think it'll work. It has to be a helicopter.
It wouldn't be as effective as far as, like, if it were a drone, because how do you take over a drone?
Right, exactly.
You don't get that human-to-machine sort of connection.
Right, and so I don't think that'll work. Mm-mm. It has to be a helicopter. Helicopters are badass. You know, the Sikorsky, Black Hawk, the Apache AH, and you got the Cobra. These things are badass.
Mm-hmm. So plus, not only that, I mean, how else do you draw the connection of, oh, this machine is supposed to keep you safe? I've never seen a fucking drone over the city of L.A.
But then again, you're not safe with that helicopter if you work in a Chinese barbecue chicken place in downtown L.A. Yeah.
Those poor chickens. Those poor workers, man. They must have suffered.
Yeah, they did. Even though they
chickens were already dead, though.
Right. So they didn't suffer. They didn't suffer. Our ratings. Okay, why don't you go first?
I will gladly go first. As far as shots and cinematography, it gets a pretty high score. As far as practical effects, I mean, everything gets a pretty high score as well. Seeing all the dogfights, seeing everything go down, seeing all the action scenes, it's pretty enjoyable. Major issues with this movie were a lot. First of all, I did not care for the main actor, the main Murphy pilot. He's a creep. He got issues. And he's just not overall very, as far as I would say, a likable protagonist.
Well, he was kind of an antagonist.
Yeah,
too.
He was an antagonist and protagonist at the same time.
Right.
The helicopter scenes were cool. And the ending of this movie, spoilers, I did not care for it. You get very little resolution. The closing scene is with him letting a train hit the helicopter and destroy it.
Yeah.
There's no closure as far as seeing the other dudes who are perpetrating the entire attacks or trying to get the helicopter approved for the riots and everything, getting arrested. You don't see any resolution with the wife. You don't get any other sort of resolution other than seeing the helicopter blow up and him getting to kill the antagonist. So I didn't really care for the overall ending, closing.
Yeah, because let's keep in mind, these military contractors, they don't have the blueprints to make another one, right?
No.
Of course not. Yeah.
Which is why I give it a 5.5 or 5 gigawatts. Gigabytes? Oh, gigabytes.
Gigabytes. Yeah. 5 out of 10 gigabytes.
5 out of 10 gigabytes.
Ooh, that's pretty low.
It is pretty low.
All right. Well, I found the action great. The dialogue was really well done. They had a pretty good script as far as the dialogue and characters in general. The performances by Warren Oates, Daniel Stern, even Roy Scheider, they were top notch. They were really a lot of veteran talent there. John Badham, he knows how to pace action. He knows how to get your adrenaline pumping.
Mm-hmm.
The aerial effects were fantastic. It's still one of my favorites. So I'll give this a 7 out of 10 gigabytes.
More generous than I.
All right. So now let's go with our final film.
The finale.
Yes. And let's find out why it's not a good idea to hack into the NORAD defense computer.
Shall we play a game?
Oh.
I think I missed him.
Yeah, weird, isn't it?
Yeah.
Love to. How about global thermonuclear war?
Wouldn't you prefer a good game of chess?
Later. Let's play global thermonuclear war.
Fine.
All right.
A young man finds a back door into a military central computer in which reality is confused with game playing, possibly starting World War III. The film we're talking about is Wargames from 1983, directed by John Badham again. So all these three films were directed by the same guy.
He just has that thing with tech taking over.
I think so. I like to refer to this as his tech trilogy. Mm-hmm. You know, how technology is great but can be used for bad, or we have unintended circumstances that arise from the use or the misuse of technology. Mm-hmm. The film stars Matthew Broderick, Ali Sheedy, again, from Short Circuit. So what was your take on this?
See, as far as this movie goes, I actually did really enjoy it, just because it's this whole thing of what really happens were we to plug AI into our military complex. And I find that fascinating, man, because that's like
terrifying.
It's fascinating and terrifying, yeah, because it's like the real life Skynet of, yeah, would it take over and would it try to just end it all, you know, sort of thing.
And what's interesting is that, you know where we are today technologically.
Terrifying.
Yeah, I mean, we have in our pockets a computer that's about the same computing power as the computers that send astronauts to the moon.
More.
And more so.
More.
Technology from 83 is nothing compared to today.
Yeah.
But it's still relevant the way it's shown in the film. Mm-hmm. Going online, which is fascinating. You see the early stages of the internet.
Yeah.
Which is a trip. Did you know about those modems? It was, you know, where you put a phone on top of it.
Put a phone on it and then, yeah.
Yeah. And that's the way they would get on the internet. So I think that, which by the way, there was a remake kind of on this, we'll get to later. But remaking this film would just basically be the same film. You have to update very, very little. Mm-hmm. You can still keep this exact same, damn near the same story as far as technology goes.
Yeah.
And that's why this film is so ahead of its time. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a film about a kid who hacks into NORAD and interacts with what he thinks is a game, and he starts what could be World War III.
Yeah.
So what part of that needs to be updated?
Okay, how easy it would be to hack into NORAD? Probably not so easy.
But
now.
But it's doable.
It's okay. But it's like the God, who was it? I don't know the kid's name, but there was a kid, I could think a couple years ago. I say kid, but he was like probably like 17, 18 at the time, who hacked into the Pentagon. He did it out of fun.
Wow.
Just because he fucking could. Do you know what kind of level of crazy that is?
Wow. And, well, did you know, I mean, every day, the Pentagon, they're constantly updating and finding new ways to protect our cyber assets.
Yeah.
You know where that started? How that came to the attention of the U.S. federal government that we need to do this?
Probably somewhere where you're obscure and weird.
War games.
Of course.
This movie prompted the federal government to ask the question, is this possible?
Yeah.
Oh, fuck. We got to do something about this. And so, in a way, this movie served an important purpose in the security of this country.
You know what's funny? If you're a big enough threat as far as being able to hack into high level of securities into the government might even pardon your crimes if you can teach them how you did it and prevent it from being done further.
Oh, yeah.
Like, they hire you as, like, I think, like, a contractor or, like, a technician or some shit.
Yeah, you're under arrest. You can face the rest of your life in prison. How'd you do it? And if you tell us, you can work for us.
And if you do it, you get pension, 401k. Wow.
Which, you know,
that's
what?
That's the type of shit, man.
Well, you know, for the most part, a lot of these hackers, they do it just for shits and giggles. They don't do it for any malice.
Yeah.
And so the government realizes this, but they can't go unpunished. Mm-hmm. So they offer them a job to keep them out of circulation from doing something worse with this.
Yeah.
I mean, imagine you got some hacker out there who's well-known in cyberspace, and terrorists find out about this guy and say, hey, come work for us. We'll give you millions of dollars.
Yeah.
That's a danger.
That's an incentive.
Yeah. So you make a liability an asset. Mm-hmm. And it's very common. It has happened a lot. Overall, I mean, it's just an amazing film in that. Well, what's also interesting. Okay. I just thought of this. Hacking was not illegal when this movie came out.
Oh, trip out.
Nope. Yeah. It was not illegal.
So it's kind of like Matthew Broderick in Ferris Bueller's Day Off, where he hacks into the school security system and changes his grade from a fucking F to an A+.
Whoa. You know what? You just tapped into something.
I know. I'm connecting all the dots.
Could Ferris Bueller be the same guy?
It is the same guy. He just grew up a little bit, man.
He grew up a little bit and moved to hacking into the government. The fact that it is ahead of its time, and it's just a terrifying film overall, because at the end, you don't know if we're at, you know, it's actually going to launch the missiles.
Yeah.
But it's still playing a game. It is only a game, but we don't know that. And that's a scary aspect of computerizing the entire system that we work, you know, that works for us, can work against us.
Mm-hmm.
So this film at the time had a budget of about 300 and no shit. It had a huge budget and it did well. How's that? Because I forgot to plug in the numbers.
Hey, you know what? It did well, and it was a good film.
It did well.
That's what we need to know.
It actually did very well at the box office. I got to see this at the Cinerama Dome in Hollywood, California.
Oh, you lucky
person, yeah, man. Which is now was known as the ArcLight,
mm-hmm.
and it has a huge concave screen.
Had. They closed it down after man.
During COVID.
Yeah.
Hopefully, they open up that place again because it was a cinematic icon.
Yeah, I think it's completely closed down. Never to reopen, and I think it's just a historic landmark at this point.
Yeah, they can't tear it down.
No.
So, but hopefully, eventually,
which is kind of a waste.
It is. It needs to reopen. I hope it does. Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times, he gave this 4 out of 4 stars. He actually liked this one.
Hey, trip out.
And he called it an amazing, entertaining thriller and one of the best films of the year, and with a wonderful ending, which it had a great ending overall. Yeah. IMDb is sitting at a 7.1, Metacritic 77, Rotten Tomatoes critic score 94%, which is certified fresh. Audience score 76%, and Letterboxd has it at 3.4 out of 5. So it's very well critically, did really great box office, and a lot of fun. Now, sequels and remakes and so forth, there was a video game that came out in 84. Or ColecoVision.
What the fuck is that?
Way ahead of your time. It was one of the computer consoles.
Jesus Christ.
And for Commodore 64.
You're saying names, but I have no idea what they mean, man.
And the Atari 8-bit computer.
I know the Atari. The 8-bit, but I know an Atari.
I mean, we're up to like how many? We don't even count bits anymore.
No.
There was a direct-to-video remake in 2008.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, did do well. It was not necessary to do a remake. Again,
I don't know how you would do a remake.
Well,
yeah.
Well, you know, you don't have to change anything. You could do an effective remake of it.
Yeah.
With better special effects, maybe, and so forth. But the story would remain the same. You know, down to the, you know, the semantics and, you know, and so forth. Because it is so relevant, even by today's standards.
Yeah.
So, what are your ratings?
So, okay, here's a couple things that I want to throw in there. As far as the, is the ICMBs, intercontinental missile. No,
ICBMs.
ICBMs, there you go. No, right. You know what I mean.
Yeah.
You know what I mean.
Right. Those dangerous things that fly through the sky.
Yeah, the things that will end humanity at some point. Right. I'm calling it, man. Those are actually in a system that is completely offline. Ooh. So as far as, I don't know if it was pre-Wargames or post-Wargames, but at some point, they realized these are too dangerous to keep in an online network.
Wow.
So they completely closed off a network where it's only connected to itself, isolated from the rest of it. It's like in an archipelago, if you will.
Archipelago.
And look at me. I'm sobering up, man. And I thought that was a little bit worth noting, meaning they can't be hacked into.
Right.
As far as the movie goes, though, it was very enjoyable, very relatable. Characters are lovable, terrifying to think about. Think about. Okay, maybe I'm not sobering up as much as I thought.
Well, let's think about it, man.
But no, it is a very relatable film as far as the technology then versus now.
Right.
And equally terrifying to think about. There you go again. Think. Fuck, man. Anyway, the whole scene. Jesus. Okay, I'm gonna slow down. The whole last scene of the movie where it's playing tic tac toe with itself.
Yeah.
And it says no one ever wins.
Wow, that was heavy.
It's war.
Yeah.
No one ever fucking wins in war.
And that was the point of the program.
Exactly. And I found that fucking ingenious.
Yeah, it was great.
Where it's finalizing its final rounds in the game, and it's saying, well, no one wins. It's always a tie.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. Mm-hmm. It's overall on a very I would say it's poetic. It's a very poetic finishing to the movie, where you realize war is meaningless.
Right.
There's no reason to be fighting against one another. It's all just for disputes and borders that are imaginary.
Right.
You know, but overall relatability, great characters, great action, great suspense, great. I give it an 8.5 gigabytes.
8.5 gigabytes. All right. Well, I found it thoroughly enjoying, and all for the same reasons you did. I mean, it's a terrifying film. It's thought-provoking. You know, Matthew Broderick, almost anything he was in the 80s was worth watching.
Bueller.
Ally Sheedy from Short Circuit, always charming and sweet to watch on film. Just great film. It's a lot of fun, and but a very important film.
Yeah.
More important than people realize. So I'll have to give this an 8 out of 10 gigawatts.
Nice. Yep. Gigabytes. Yeah. See, you don't even know what we're doing.
So I give it an 8.10 gigabytes out of 10.
8.10 out of 10?
8.10 out of 10.
Yeah, we've been drinking now, bud.
So if you like these kind of films, I mean, here's a few other recommendations. Terminator 2 from 1991. I think it's the epitome of dangers in technology and artificial intelligence.
Yeah.
Just an amazing, just classic. One of the best sequels ever made.
Yeah.
Blade Runner from 1982.
Nice.
Great film about the use of androids and artificial intelligence as well. And it kind of does mirror some of the themes from Short Circuit of, you know, I am alive because I am there, you know, therefore I am.
Yeah.
And it's a pretty fascinating and very deep, thought-provoking film. Great special effects. A movie called Electric Dreams from 1984. Mm-hmm. And it's basically a love triangle between a man, a girl, and a computer.
Nice.
Yeah. And it's, you know, computer falls in love with this guy, but has issues with the fact that he's in love with this girl. It's really a trippy film. It was a small indie film back in the 80s. And definitely worth a watch. And my final recommendation that I highly recommend is a film called Demon Seed.
Okay.
From 1977. And it's about a woman who lives in a high-tech AI-assisted house.
Interesting.
Like the Alexa home and stuff. It's the same
thing. The smart home.
You know, turn down the lights, close the windows, turn on the AC. And the computer gets possessed by a demon.
Mm.
And locks her up in the home. And ends up impregnating her.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, it's a really underrated...
No, not Jesus, a demon, apparently.
A demon, right. it's a really dark, scary film, and one that's just completely disappeared from existence on streaming platforms. People have forgotten about it. Great film. Highly recommend it. Very creepy, slow-paced, but it's a hell of a movie.
Can I give one?
Yes.
I don't remember when this movie... I think it was 2018 or 13. I don't remember when. But it stars Joaquin Phoenix,
mm-hmm.
and it's about Joaquin Phoenix's character falling in love with an AI.
Oh.
It's called Her.
I've heard of this.
It is such a great movie.
Wow.
So good. It follows the theme of, like, what does it mean for an AI? At what point does an AI become like,
emotionally
human, you know, as far as how far can we go, as far as can we love an AI?
Because emotion is part of being human.
Yeah.
Wow.
So it's a very good film.
I might check that out. It sounds very interesting.
It's great fucking
movie. Well, Ex Machina is another one.
Yeah, you know who stars or who voices the AI?
Huh.
I'm pretty sure, don't quote me, Scarlett Johansson.
Oh, yeah. They went there.
Yeah.
Wow. Man. Okay, well, I'm definitely going to look that one up. So any closing thoughts before we give you a preview of what's coming up next week?
I give it 50 years before we fuck ourselves over and end humanity.
I give it 40.
Yeah, you know what? That's more generous than I.
Yeah. So, next week, let's get ready to fire it up and get high.
Ah.
We're going to go with some cannabis-based movies. Marijuana films.
We're doing this fucking episode.
We're going to go with Half-Baked.
Nice.
Dazed and Confused.
Nice.
And Cheech and Chong, Up and Smoke.
Mind you, may I add this note? I've been fighting for this episode for God knows how long. Since I think it was 420 of this year's, I was like, why don't we do an episode on our favorite stoner films, man?
Yeah, you know, I've been wanting to do it, but it just, I'm like, wow, this is a good one. I don't want to waste it. I don't want to do it right away. I want to take my time. But
yeah.
We got to do it. We got to do it.
Dude, it's such a funny episode. Yeah,
especially Cheech and Chong's Up in Smoke, which is.
I love Cheech and Chong.
Oh, it's the grandfather of the pot movie. So definitely, for all of you, check these movies out before you listen to our episode next week. You won't regret it.
Oh, man. Especially it's so funny.
Half-Baked. They're all hilarious.
Yeah.
In fact, Days of Confused, that was with Matthew McConaughey.
Was it?
I believe so. In fact, that's where he came up with the dialogue, all right, all right, all right.
All right, all right, all right.
Which was ad-libbed, and it was improvised right there on the spot.
Trip out, man.
And now it's his catchphrase. So let's start winding this down. We hope you enjoyed our show and this episode. So please help to support the pod by giving us a nice 5-star rating. Leave a good review. Another way you can support is just simply to subscribe and or follow us on Amazon, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Deezer, Audible, Boomplay, or wherever you get your podcast fix. Also, don't forget to drop by our Facebook group. Leave a message. Talk to us. Let us know what you think. Check us out on Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, and check out our YouTube channel where we have all our current episodes. All these links, they're in our show notes. You can also contact us directly via email to thefilmjoepod@gmail.com. We'd love to hear your feedback. So, any final words?
Deus ex machina.
Ooh, that's heavy.
You know what that means?
No.
It's from Donnie Darko. It means God from the machine.
Ooh, that's perfect way to end this episode.
Yeah.
Perfect. All right. Well, I'm Joe.
I'm Carlos.
And this is the Film Joe Podcast,
where film talk happens.